There's a post-hardcore band called Make Do and Mend. Seriously? And welcome back to So Biased. My name is Melissa, and you are joining me for the Costume Symposium. Costume Symposium is a weekend where we all make a whole bunch of content and have all sorts of different activities that have to do with historical costuming, and we do tutorials and sew-alongs and events, and we put together all sorts of special content for you. If you're new to this channel, my name is Melissa, and I sew primarily clothing from the 1930s and 40s with a specific fascination into World War II history and World War II clothing. In my Costume Symposium video for last year, I covered the CC-41 utility clothing scheme that the British government did for World War II in order to ration clothing that used as little fabric and as little waste as possible. In today's video, I am going to be covering the Make Do and Mend scheme. Make Do and Mend was another initiative of the British government during World War II as a means of economizing on fabric and clothing and scraps, and it was a collaboration with the British Board of Trade. So during World War II, fabric was very difficult to obtain because the UK is an island and because they relied on getting a lot of their supplies from overseas. The Germans used a massive U-boat campaign to sink a lot of the merchant vessels that were trying to bring goods to the UK. This caused huge shortages in a lot of items, and one of the things that they needed was clothing for the war effort. So fabrics for uniforms, for tenting, for parachutes, for everything you could imagine to keep tens of thousands of uniforms being manufactured on a regular basis. So civilians were asked to economize. In order to make this work, the government would issue coupons to people. You'd get coupons for food in terms of what foods you could get every week. You would get fuel coupons if you wanted to buy gas or petrol, as they would call it. And you got coupons for clothing. And in order to purchase an item of clothing, you would need to have not only the money to purchase it, but the coupons to buy it. And the coupons that you were given got fewer and fewer every year as the shortages got worse and worse. So if you could only buy, say, one new suit in an entire year, you needed to make your clothing last a really long time. So the Ministry of Information partnered with the Board of Trade to create a campaign called Make Do and Mend. And this was to encourage people to, rather than buy new clothes, to fix the clothes they had or repurpose them into something else. This is very much the first in terms of a slow fashion movement, as well as in like upcycling as a whole movement that was started by the government. This was all part of what were called clothing austerity measures, which were designed to keep the purchase of new garments as small as possible. Now, in order to keep this movement going, the government started creating pamphlets, as well as commercials and film reels and newsreels about the Make Do and Mend movement. They even created a mascot, and the mascot is hilarious. Also slightly creepy. So the mascot is named Mrs. So-and-so, S-E-W and S-E-W. She is kind of the quintessential housewifey looking person ever. Also a doll, like a doll that's made to look like an adult housewife. And she also got featured in newsreels so people could see her economizing and mending clothing. I have some of the newsreels and footage that they had here, and I will show you just bits of them, and they are phenomenal. Warning, they are sexist AF. This campaign was entirely designed for women, particularly housewives, to remake clothing for themselves, for their children, and for the men folk, which is particularly ironic because the vast majority of women at this time had to go work in like factories to keep up with the war effort.
Here is Mrs. Quilty on her way to the bathroom. She's wearing a patchwork dressing gown made of odd pieces of material. The lining was formerly a dust sheet. Her pajamas are made from pieces of material found in the attic, presumably great-grandmama's bed valance. Mrs. Clark made her frock from a pair of her husband's old plus-four trousers and half a yard of new material.
So you can see in this footage that they include ideas on how to make something new out of something old, how to make a dress out of a skirt, how to repurpose a jacket into a smaller size. If the bottom is frayed, if it doesn't fit anymore, remove and ad bits, particularly for children, as they grew. Children were given more coupons for clothing because obviously they were growing a lot faster, but there were lots of ways that people were taught to economize on children's clothing. One of the ones I love were these dress patterns where you would have a bodice and a skirt, and as the child got older, you could add belt pieces in succession to make the dress longer in the torso as the child got larger. And you could use that same band from the waist along the bottom to make it longer so that it wasn't inappropriately short for a young child as they got taller. The Board of Trade released all sorts of different kind of pamphlets with how-to tutorials on how to economize in lots of different ways. I've been able to track down most of these. I'm going to post some of them in the description below. If you want to see all of the ones I've been able to find, and I have almost a dozen full pamphlets, please go to my Ko-fi. I have all of my sources are available to my Ko-fi subscribers, so please feel free to buy me a Ko-fi if you want to see all of the juicy details. Some of the different pamphlets include how to patch a shirt, how to patch an overall. Overalls aren't the kind of coverall things that we think of in North America. This is more like how to patch a shirt or a dress. How to patch elbows and trousers, trousers obviously being pants. They actually have really clever ways of adding a large patch to the crotch seam of pants so that they will not only repair like a massive tear, but they'll also be stronger and you can make them a little bit extra roomy if you need that. Then there's how to patch sheets and blankets. This one I find fascinating because could you imagine doing patchwork on your own bed sheets? I feel that would be like texturally weird to sleep in. They also had patterns for how to repurpose used out sheets and blankets into clothing, which were phenomenal. How to darn holes and tears. Yes, so this one is how to darn knitwear. So if you have socks or a sweater or something that has a hole in it, it shows you how to pick up all of the loose fibers and knit them back into the existing garment. How to reinforce for extra wear. So if you have kids who are really active, you can take their clothing and before they wear them out, you can patch the knees and the bum and the cuffs so that they're not gonna wear out as quickly. Now, the one thing about a lot of these tutorials is they have an assumption that you will be able to sew at a basic level, that you've already learned basic sewing techniques, particularly hand sewing, and you'll know here's what this kind of stitch is, here's what that is, here's what kind of thread to use or needle to use. One of my favorite of these pamphlets is how to look after parachute nylon. So nylon and silk in particular was really hard to obtain because they were rationed primarily for use in parachutes. Nylon was also used for things like straps and other military needs, but silk was highly in demand for parachutes because they are very light and very strong. As such, they became a really hot commodity. And there are stories of soldiers, particularly parachutists and airborne, who would save their reserve chute. So the main chute you wear on your back and your reserve chute you wear on your stomach in this style of parachuting. And so there are tales of parachuters who landed, say, at Normandy or at Market Garden or wherever, and they would walk around with their parachute and just hang on to it forever so that they could either ship it or go with it back to the UK or back home because they were marrying their girlfriend or their fiance and they wanted them to have white silk that they could make a dress with. And there are a whole bunch of extant examples of these parachute wedding dresses and they're just beautiful. Seriously, I need to find a silk parachute and make a dress out of it because that would be the coolest dress of all time. I also mentioned this in my CC41 video. Another thing that people had as far as silk were silk escape maps. So if you were particularly in the Air Force, but other operations working kind of forward close to enemy lines or behind enemy lines, they'd be given maps of the area that were printed on silk. The reason for this is silk isn't going to wash away. So if you get a paper map wet, you can ruin it. It can tear apart, but silk won't. Also, they're really easy to hide. So you can actually sew them into the lining of a pocket. And so when you need them, you can just pull them out. So if you're captured, you can still keep the map on you and you'll still be able to have it on your person. And so there is at least one extant example of Patricia Mountbatten asking her boyfriend, who was in the Royal Air Force, to give his old silk escape map to her, and she had a pair of lingerie made out of it, like a bra and panties, and it's available at the Imperial War Museum, and it is amazing. And if that's not the ultimate example of make, do, and mend, I do not know what is. So the make, do, and mend, there was a lot of information about mending, but there is just as much being released about making your own clothing, about how to repurpose what you had into something else. And this included releasing patterns of how to lay out a dress pattern on a men's suit jacket, how to take a pair of pants, an older man, and repurpose them and recut them for a boy. Other guides would include stuff like alterations of how to make a dress bigger or smaller. If you needed to take a dress out, they had examples where you would have a contrasting color from underneath the arm all the way down the dress on both sides. And what that would do, it would allow you to take out the dress by almost 6 inches by just putting a 3-inch strip on both sides. You could also make it longer by adding the same contrasting strip around the bottom or around the waist. Other patterns involved how to make a nightdress out of used sheets. To give you an idea of how short supplied the UK was and how many coupons you were able to spend, an average person in the height of the war got something like, I think it was 26 or 28 coupons. And a coat with a lining would cost you 13. So you buy one coat and that's half of all of your clothing purchases for the entire year. A pair of pants, just a single pair of pants, would be 8 coupons, and a regular dress would be somewhere between 7 and 11 coupons. So 3 dresses and you're done. That's it for the whole year. And that also means you cannot buy underwear or stockings or pajamas. You can't buy socks or gloves or hats. You can't buy ties, handkerchiefs, bathing suits, or even so much as a bathrobe. So if you bought 3 dresses, you had to make your underwear last for the entire year. Another thing you would see a lot in the make do and mend movement were secondhand clothing sales. And oftentimes they would do them the way we see a lot now, where you would get a bunch of parents together and they would trade out all of their kids' clothing for a larger size, as well as secondhand clothing stores sprung up where this hadn't really been that common before. Because secondhand clothing didn't actually require coupons. Now, it didn't require coupons, but it had to be sold below a certain price, and the government set those prices. So you couldn't sell secondhand clothing for more than what about half the regular cost was, and so the market for secondhand clothing skyrocketed during the war. The other thing too is it was illegal to trade, sell, or transfer coupons from one person to another other than within an immediate family, and so the black market in terms of coupon sales was very small, and the government was very smart about this because you could only use the coupons in particular months or particular times of year, and you had to bring the book with the coupons in it, and the salesperson would have to cut them out of your book. If they were removed from the book, they weren't considered valid. So you had to show your book and your identification with the same name on it in order to use the coupons, which really helped prevent a whole lot of fraud. Not that there wasn't any. There's always a black market. There's always fraud taking place. And the government took that real seriously. If you were caught buying or selling ration coupons, you could be fined £100, which at the time was a ton of money, or imprisoned for 3 months. Another really interesting part of the make do and mend movement is how they taught you how to wash clothing, how to do without washing in hot water, ironing with a hot iron, using way less soap, using leftover water from a bath or from washing dishes. A lot of people used to send stuff out to a laundry. You could just drop off your laundry and it would be cleaned and pressed, but that was a lot more difficult to obtain during the war, so people were washing stuff who maybe hadn't before. Now, beyond this, they also had tutorials on footwear. This includes a pamphlet on how to make household slippers out of crochet or out of wool, something that you could easily make, including patterns on how to cut out a sole in different sizes, as well as the patterns of here's the approximate size you make them so that people were not wearing their work shoes in the home. This is also a time when wearing shoes in the home was very, very common. Did people use these pamphlets? Did they learn all these new skills? Did they maintain all of their clothing? Well, the government knew that the pamphlets wouldn't be enough, and so they actually had in-person classes. You could go into a class, most of them were free of charge, run by the government, and they would show you how to make a dress out of a simple pattern, how to lay it out, how to cut it, how to sew it together. And some of these classes were free. Sometimes they would cost something like a shilling, which wasn't an exorbitant expense, and it wouldn't be 1 shilling for a class, it would be 1 shilling for a whole term. And it would include not just the make, do, amend information, but things like first aid classes, which would be really useful if you were living in London during the Blitz and getting bombed. Fun story, my grandmother lived in London during the Blitz, and she said that she and her friends, when they would be evacuating, knew how to count the bombs because they knew how many bombs would be in a cluster in each bomber, and so they knew when one cluster was finished. Weird skills you pick up. They also had what were called equipment pools. So they would have kind of communal sewing machines that you could borrow. Obviously, you're not going to be making 20 dresses because fabric was also rationed, but you could borrow it for a few weeks make a few garments, repair the garments you have, bring it back to the class so that other people can borrow it. And this was very much financed and assisted by the government, and these were available for a very nominal fee. Was the Make Do and Mend project successful? Absolutely. There was a huge amount of interest in it, mostly because of absolute necessity, but they diverted millions of yards of fabric away from civilian use, and people were able to economize at a level that was completely unprecedented and has not actually been seen in the Western world since. Especially now with the eras of fast fashion and manufacturers who are coming out with new micro trends every single week for fashion that doesn't last more than one or two washes. This is a movement that really needs to come back. The idea that you can maintain a garment and just keep repairing it endlessly until it completely wears to pieces is something that's so unfamiliar to us. And it's a skill that most of us just don't have anymore. And while I absolutely do not want to glamorize in any way the concept of war or World War II specifically, the deprivations of war require a lot of economy. They require a lot of different thinking, and you don't have access to everything that you could ever want, and so you do have to find another way. Now, how does this translate to the modern era? This is a movement that is coming up now. There are all sorts of tool libraries. Public libraries now have sewing machines that you can check out as part of your library card. I swear, this is a thing. Look up your local libraries. Libraries are amazing. There are also fabric swaps, clothing swaps. There are so many tutorials online of repurposing thrifted clothing. Fashion waste is one of the greatest causes of waste in the planet. And if you think that donating your clothing to a charity is making a huge difference, it's not. There have been numerous reports that have shown the amount of donating clothing that ends up in developed countries is actually destroying industries. If barrels of free clothing are being shipped in all the time, these places have no chance of making a living, and it's screwing up their economy even worse. The vast majority of it, even if you donate it, still ends up in a landfill. Well, that's it for this video. I hope you enjoyed the little trip into the Make Do and Mend movement. I have other videos that are part of the CauseTube Symposium, and I will make a link to the CauseTube Symposium Instagram as well as to the playlist, so you can see all sorts of new and old makers that you may have never heard of before or have been following for years. As for me, I will be doing a panel on disability in costuming, but I will link to that as well up here and down below. I will also link to my CC41 utility clothing videos and my other World War II relevant content. Please like and subscribe if you enjoyed this video. Please leave me a comment as to what your favorite pieces that you've mended or repurposed or upcycled somehow. I would love to hear about how this movement speaks to you. I'm sorry it's been so long since I made a video, but life has been crazy. I hope to have a whole bunch more content for you soon. But until then, stay happy and healthy, stay safe, take care of each other, and we'll see you all soon. Bye!
Or why not get together with your friends and form a make, do, and mend group? Then you can all help each other.
So the Ministry of I'm going to point some of the different pamphlets. Now, was the Make, Do, and Mend project successful?